Good evening. I'm Jim Plummer, the Dean of the Engineering School, and I'd like to welcome all of you here this evening. We're here, of course, to celebrate a very, very distinguished person that I'm delighted and honored to have, and I'll introduce him in just a moment. But let me just begin by noting that the auditorium is jam-packed. We have standing people, standing row people in the back, and we have literally hundreds more people who are watching this through a live webcast over the internet. So Ken Arrow is the person that we're here to honor tonight as part of the School of Engineering Heroes program. Ken is obviously a Nobel Prize-winning economist, and he's the John Kenney Professor of Economics. And so why, you might ask, is an economist a School of Engineering hero? And part of the answer is right up here. If you look at Ken's title, he's a professor emeritus in the Management Science and Engineering Department. He was actually one of the founders and one of the first faculty members in the Operations Research Department, which was one of the original three departments in the School of Engineering that was merged a decade or more ago to form MS&E, which is the current department that houses operations research. So we're just delighted to have you here with us tonight, Ken. The Stanford Engineering Heroes program, which is now in its third year, recognizes the achievements of Stanford engineers who have profoundly advanced the course of human, social, and economic progress through engineering. To date, there are 29 heroes that we have recognized, including six this year. In addition to Ken, the other heroes that we announced this year are Sergey Brin and Larry Page, who are the founders of Google, Sally Ride, who was obviously an astronaut and a distinguished advocate for STEM education, and she also has three Stanford degrees. Ingmard Pflugge-Lotz, who was the first female faculty member in the School of Engineering, and Ed Ginston, who of course was the inventor of the klystron radio tube, which played a profound effect in the Second World War. These six new heroes join a group of very distinguished people and includes people like Bill Hewlett, Dave Packard, Fred Terman, Vint Cerf, and Marty Hellman, who is sitting here in the front row. Welcome, Marty. Unlike many events like this, all that we ask of people we're trying to honor in this way is what they would like to do if they came and spent some time in the engineering school. And Ken and I just spent, I think, a delightful dinner with six or eight PhD students, mostly from the Management Science and Engineering Department, who peppered him with questions. And most of them were about the future. What are you working on? What great ideas do you have? What do you think about my topic I'm working on? It was so really an interesting discussion about looking forward on the opportunities for research in the areas that Ken has been working on for decades. Ken won his Nobel Prize in economics together with Sir John Hicks in 1972 for pioneering contributions to general equilibrium theory and welfare theory. These are the theories that underlie the assessment of business risk in government, economic, and welfare policies. And interestingly enough, 40 years later, he remains the youngest person ever to receive this award. Ken is widely recognized as one of the 20th century's most influential economists. One of the more impressive and interesting things about Ken is that he's applied economic theory to real-world problems. He's written and studied topics such as the economics of racial discrimination, malaria drugs, climate change, innovation, and healthcare. He grew up in New York City during the Depression and attended City College, graduating in 1940 in mathematics and social science. He then went to graduate work at Columbia with the intention of majoring in statistics. But my understanding is that he took a course in mathematical economics, and that, along with the promise of a graduate fellowship in economics, caused him to think that economics was maybe a better choice for his graduate work. Like many others, at that time, his graduate work was interrupted by the Second World War, and during the war, he was a weather officer in the Army Air Corps, and it was actually during that time that his interest in operations research began. The field grew up quickly during the war because it was employed for such things as efficiently deploying troops and materials and such things, and Ken's first published paper, actually, which had the title On the Optimal Use of Winds for Flight Planning, was the outgrowth of his military work, and it's a paper which obviously was about using the curvature of the earth and winds and so on to minimize fuel use in aircraft. It's still used today. He came to Stanford in 1949 as an acting assistant professor in economics and statistics, and shortly after that, when the operations research department was formed, actually not shortly, but some time after that, Ken became a faculty member in a third department here at Stanford, the operations research department, and quickly rose to the rank of professor. Another interesting thing about him is that he's been a highly influential person, not just in terms of his publications and the impact that he's had on the world through his writing and studying, but also because he's an incredibly inspirational teacher. Now, I didn't know this until I learned a bit more about Ken, but five of his former students have also gone on to win Nobel Prizes, and that says something about mentoring of students. I'm actually stepping down the end of this year, and I'd like to become one of your students if I could. Even among his peers, Ken's intellect and breadth of interest is legendary, and he has interests that range from Shakespeare to Chinese art to English history and much, much more, and I think perhaps some of that may come through in the discussions this evening. He's won, in addition to the Nobel Prize, many, many other awards. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences and the American Philosophical Society. He's a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the Econometrics Society, the Institute of Mathematical Statistics, the American Statistical Association, and he received the National Medal of Science for his research on the problem of making decisions using imperfect information and his research on bearing risk. So tonight, Ken, we're celebrating you as a School of Engineering hero. And you'll see when you walk out of the room, and if you go to the right, there's a wall next to this auditorium that has panels that have a plaque for each of the engineering heroes. And this is a replica, Ken, of the plaque that is already up there with your picture on it and representing the fact that you're our latest engineering hero. So congratulations, and please join me in welcoming Ken Arrow.
Dear colleagues, this is not going to be a very formal lecture. I don't know if you're prepared to go through the latest discussions about the mathematical considerations for the long-term discount rate applicable to, well, it's a real problem that's applicable to climate change. But I would be rather little reminiscent of the different strands, as I've indicated by the title, in my career. So I'm going to be alternating between an evolutionary development in the fields and a certain amount of autobiography, one illustrating the other, I hope. Dean Plummer has already indicated there were some interesting points about how I became an economist. And indeed, he's got he's understood the facts, but it's part of the evolution. Remember, 3640 was my college career. This was a period even worse than the current next, please. It's even worse than the current recession. This is the Great Recession. That was the Great Depression. That lasted a long time. The unemployment rates were much higher than they are today. And my father, certainly from a really comfortable position, was living from hand to mouth. So, of course, one of the things you tend to develop, and it's quite rational and in accordance with economic theory, is a concern for security. And here I was going to college with the idea that at some point this was going to lead to a career, and I had to consider the question of security and of a job, what potential kind of jobs. And I was sufficiently advanced even to think of the idea of flexibility, a topic which has become more important in economics since. In other words, that you don't know what the world is going to be like, so you have to prepare for alternative occupations. Well, I had, from my high school clear, I had some degree of mathematical talent. What do you do with it? Well, it's one very obvious thing. You become a high school teacher. It's funny, but that's exactly what I was saying. If you had asked me at that time, that's exactly what I intended to be. And indeed, this involved taking a certain rather considerable fraction of my valuable college time taking courses in education, in educational psychology. I don't think they contributed much to my long-run future, as it happens. In fact, there was only one problem with my decision. It was a very sensible idea. It was a very secure job. It paid pretty well by the standards of that day. And in fact, it only turned out there was only one problem with it, namely, a problem of supply and demand. Namely, that in 1933, they had given an examination for teachers of mathematics, high school teachers of mathematics. By 1940, there were still people who had passed that examination and had not yet been hired. And therefore, they would not give another examination until the list was used up. That's how I decided to become a graduate student instead. But you see, I was considering flexibility. I knew that you never know about being a high school teacher, man. Even before I knew quite how bad the situation was becoming. So I thought, well, what else do you do in mathematics? And I thought, oh, there's something called statistics. So the math department gave a course in statistics. It was given, as was pretty obvious at the time, that by somebody who didn't know much about it. But he did have a good reading list. That was what gave me. I started reading the original papers and things like that, and really got fascinated by the subject. So when I decided to be a graduate, I wanted to study statistics. Well, statistics was not a field in which you could get a degree anywhere. There was a distinguished statistician at Columbia who was a professor of economics. Somehow the statistics department, he had in fact written, his name was Harold Hotelling, a name that's still, I think, well known. And he was had written, interestingly enough, some papers in economics proper, mathematical economics, which was then not a very widespread, the use of mathematics in economics was not widespread, but there was a minority. There was a little bit of a tradition of that going back even to the 19th century. And so we started taking courses with him. And I noticed he was giving a course in mathematical economics. I enrolled in the math department, not figuring what's the closest thing to statistics. That was simply a mistake. Mathematics department at Columbia and mathematics departments in general have not had a high opinion of statistics as an academic discipline. I think that remains true. So first, as I got I noticed Hotel giving his course in economics, out of sheer curiosity, I took it. And I was fascinated. I really changed things. And then, but nevertheless, I was going on. I talked to Professor Hotel about would he write a letter of recommendation for me for a scholarship in mathematics, just so I certainly could not continue my graduate study otherwise. And he said, well, he didn't think he had much influence in the math department, but if perchance I should change my field to economics, he thought he'd have a little more, the chances that his support would matter would be higher. So I was bought. So you see, economics really predicts quite well, or at least in that one case it did. So now I began to acquire, and I've really learned what we call microeconomics, which is the more formal part of the theory. I won't try to define what I mean by that exactly. But there are two basic elements to it. It's a hypothesis about how the world of marketing, the exchange of goods for sale and purchase and so forth behave. And the one is, the world is made up of households and firms, and they're rational. If, in the case of the firm, they want to make as much money as possible. You take prices, each firm takes prices as given and chooses its inputs and its outputs so as to maximize the profit. And that led a parallel kind of argument came in for the household, but it was a little more complicated. This goes back to the 19th century. Namely, there's something they're trying to maximize. Exactly what it is, it's a little hard, mysterious, but it's there's something that they have. They take all the possible kinds of consumption, all the vectors describing consumption, they want to choose the best that they can afford. So there's maximization subject to a constraint, namely that, that what you spend can't be more than what you earn. So this meant, essentially, we were learning about maximization of the constraints. Now, we're not, this isn't programming because we had non-negativity constraints were not part of the story. They were sort of taken for granted somehow. But you learned about Lagrangians, you learned about second-order conditions, if I may mention that in this audience. And there is the, not only the idea that derivatives should be, well, whatever they should be under Lagrangian multiplier, they're equal or something, but the depending on how you formulate it. But they should. But also, there are second-order conditions, determinants, conditions of the present. I was really a great expert on manipulating bordered Hessians, which is what they call it. But there's a, that's one element of microeconomics, that given the set of prices, everybody's behaving rationally. So some people are buying, some people are selling. But of course, in order for this to work, somehow what's supplied had better be what's demanded. It's got to keep. So the second part of the story is that supply equals demand. And this is a general equilibrium formulation. It sounds simpler than it, I'm making it sound simpler than it is. But hoteling was, of course, was entirely on the first part of the story, not the second. In fact, that's why I found that I learned about general equilibrium from not from any course, but from the fact that my desk, like all other graduate students, was located in the library, close to where the economics books were, in the stacks. And so I would simply go to the stacks and start flipping books around and see if there's anything interesting. And I discovered a book by John Hicks called Value and Capital. And in exchange, nobody at Columbia ever knew anything about this book. But as you go talk to people educated elsewhere, say in England, they were people of my generation were all transformed by this book. And that's why when many years later I got the prize jointly with Hicks, it was an especially great honor to be this man who, whose work I admired so much and it was so influential to me. Now, as Dean Plummer has mentioned, I had experience of like a lot of, like about 10 million of my fellow young people of serving in the armed forces. Since I had this mathematical training and so forth, it was kind of reasonable to try to do something, get into something which would at least use some of these talents. And the nearest thing I could find was weather, meteorology. So I enlisted in the weather training program, sent to New York University, which had a meteorology department. There were meteorology, the statistics departments were virtually non-existent then. Meteorology departments are few, and that's, they remain to this day. I think there only are four or five of them in this country. It's not a widespread thing. We have none at Stanford. I think UCLA is the only university on the West Coast that has one. I was sent to New York University and had roughly a master, the equivalent of a master's degree. Well, the one thing I did here when I was there was one of the first courses was what's called dynamic meteorology, which is essentially the basic physics of the atmosphere. And the professor, Panofsky, not the Panofsky who was here, but his brother, twin brother, was trying to explain why the Earth is as warm as it, why the temperature of the Earth is what it is and not a lot warmer or a lot colder. Why does it sort of, you know, vary between in Fahrenheit between, say, 0 and 100, roughly. Why isn't 200, or why isn't minus 20? And he explained it had to do with the trace gases. Nitrogen, oxygen have nothing to do with the issue, whatever. They're like glass. Heat comes in, it goes out. But there were these gases of relatively small amounts, which regulate, which are, will let in, for example, in case of carbon dioxide, will let in the heat from the sun, but tend to block the outgoing heat, which is in the form of infrared rays. And there was carbon, there were a number of other things, but he said, we've been burning a lot more in the last couple of hundred years than we ever did before, and therefore, all the evidence is that the Earth is warming. I didn't hear much more about that for about 20 years. And then I said, oh yeah, that's what Dr. Panofsky told us. And it was, of course, I think it's quite right. Okay, this was my train. But meanwhile, they sent me to do research on long-range forecasting, long-range means 2 weeks, by the way. If you think it's a joke, you can, let me assure you, we're not there yet. But we all, I began to hear it as I was commissioned. It was something the British were doing called operations research. I don't watch my time here. They were taking scientists of various kinds to look at military issues. And they found, of course, there was a vast amount of thought, the tactics, how to load a gun, I remember, a cannon, which it's nobody had reexamined in 50 years. And so it turns out there were a lot of things that were silly. They were doing things, for example, that may have been appropriate for a gun that is no longer in existence or something like that. And nobody had ever challenged these things. One big research was to how to locate the gunners or how to armor the gunners on a bomber. How to armor them or how to locate them so they'd be less vulnerable to attack by enemy interceptors. Just as an example sort of thing. Well, in the course of my career as in this research department, which as I said, I did anything very successful. I tried a lot of things, but I don't think it was any more successful than anybody else. But at one point there came an essay, whatever, or a study by some contractor about how to navigate planes with making use of the winds. Now, their question was how to simplify the navigation, which struck me as not, the navigation didn't seem all that complicated, it was worth simplifying, but the question's the wrong question. The answer was reasonable enough, but the question was wrong. The real question is how do you go from A to B as fast as possible? I should say, it wasn't so much a question of getting there as fast as possible, but of burning as little fuel. Which is, of course, the same thing. But the real scarcity wasn't, you were not terribly interested in how fast the planes got to their target, but you were. Or, in fact, the main issue was actually delivering the bombers across the Atlantic. Bombers could fly from Newfoundland to Scotland, from Gander to Prestwick. And this is a pre-jet era, you understand. So it was 10 to 12 hours. And of course, the winds over the North Atlantic can be pretty intense. So if you can sort of take advantage of them, you might be able to get there faster. And as I say, where you weren't, speed wasn't the important thing, but the important thing was saving fuel. You wanted the time in the air as short as possible. Well, some applied mathematician, Willy Prager, came by, and so I asked him if there's any literature on this subject. Oh, yes, yes, and he gave me two references in German. But, In those days, German was very dominant in mathematics instruction. In fact, there was a course at City College where the textbook was in German, believe it or not. And I, so the result is I took a year of German. And of course, mathematical German is just a lot easier than a newspaper or a novel. No, it really is. It's the vocabulary is limited, and it's much easier. I don't want to claim great credit. I'm not a great linguist, but I was had enough. So with the aid of a dictionary, I was read these articles, and I found one to my surprise. Well, it was a calculus of variations problem. Well, they gave a solution all right. They assumed the world was flat. I'm not sure. Now, if you're flying 300 miles, that's probably a perfectly, there's probably nothing wrong with that. But if we were flying, you know, a couple of thousand miles, and I thought maybe the fact that the Earth was curved matters. So I spent my time reworking the problem to take account of the curvature of the Earth, and I was able to solve it. I then figured out a way to compute it. Remember, this is pre-electronic computers. I'll come back to that point. I developed nomograms and a whole thing with different kinds of graphs, and figured out a way in which a person not with no mathematical training, I could get the assistance from people who didn't have, were reasonably intelligent but didn't have any mathematical training. They could plot this like in a half an hour. Now, you had to keep on replotting it until you got to make sure the place went to where you went to go. You'd start off from a point and pick a heading. And along that path, it was as fast as you could go, but it might not go to where you wanted to go. So if you missed it, you'd try another way of doing it. And but it didn't take more than a couple of hours. And I did it on lots of old trajectories and showed that we were saving about 2 hours out of 12. Nobody could understand what I was doing, and the director, the head of the unit, did not take this up as a cause. So it did, I think, eventually have an impact on the air travel, but not during the war, unfortunately. But you see, that was a kind of an operations research problem. That's the point I'm getting at. So already, the idea of taking a highly specific issue, modeling it, choosing a criterion function. In this case, it was a pretty obvious one, but there was the idea that you reduce it to an extremization, a maximization or minimization problem, and that you had tools which enabled you to actually compute. This was an example of something which people were doing in one scale or another. Sometimes it was very simple. Mathematics was very simple. It was just thinking about the problem that was important. Other times, there was some sophistication to it, and particularly queuing. So I was saying I was already, in a way, involved in a kind of an OR way of thinking without the term, realized I was doing it. Okay. Right after the war, well, I continued my, went back to Columbia for my graduate study. I won't go into my personal history here. I went to Chicago to a group called the Coles Commission for Research in Economics, which is eventually found a home in Yale. We began to hear about a development that people in the Defense Department were concerned with, which they were trying to, for example, engage in a provision where you train people for a task, you get supplies for the task, you want these to arrive at the same time. So there was a what they call an activity analysis model today. And this was developed by a man named Marshall Wood, who seemed to be president, but especially by George Danziger, who had come to work in for defense during the war and was still in the Defense Department at that time. He had gotten his PhD in statistics at Berkeley, which had developed a statistical development under J.R.C. Naiman. And you could formulate this as the optimization of linear functions subject to linear constraints, but with non-negativity, with inequality constraints as well as equality constraints. The question was, though, how to solve this, how to really solve the problem. You could formulate it, you could have interesting ideas about duality, but the question formulated, and he developed the simplex method. Now, this suddenly meant there was a whole variety of problems, because you could write lots of things as linear programs. And it provided a way of solving these problems with computers that were available, with hand computers. The problem wasn't too big, of course. It was a and so we at the Coles Commission, one of my colleagues, Leonard Hurwitz, used to go down to it and keep track of what Danzig was doing and report it to us. One of our leading people there, Charlie Copmans, had in fact solved the linear programming problem during the war. He was concerned with getting, you have a network of ports, and you want to deliver some goods to some ports and then take goods there and take them somewhere else. So in other words, essentially the idea is you wanted deliveries, you had sources and you had points of delivery, and you wanted to get things. And the question is how to do it in the minimum amount of shipping. Now that is a linear programming problem, but it happens to be an especially simple one. And he had solved it for this. So he, as soon as he heard about it, he recognized its importance, connected it up with economic theory, and did arrange a number of conferences, which made this subject, helped subject take off. In fact, a Soviet mathematician named Kantorovich had worked on a similar problem. He was a very abstract mathematician, but he felt he should be doing something, apparently, or maybe was urged to do something to help industry. So he got in touch with a plywood manufacturing firm in the Soviet Union and reduced a lot of their issues to a linear program. This was about 1939. And formulated the mathematics of it, but he really did not have a practical way of solving it. With two or three or four variables, you had a characterization of what the optimal solution was. So with a little guesswork, you could solve it, but that would not work at all with any major number of variables. And his work was kind of suppressed because it began to look entirely too much like bourgeois economics. These dual variables looked an awful lot like prices, and this is complete. No, that's quite serious. He wrote an expository book, and it wasn't published for 20 years. By the time it was published, of course, it was completely out of date. But it was now. So you had so suddenly a whole class of OR problems locked into existence, and it was coincidentally. Maybe not coincidentally, who knows, there was a lucky development. Computing got revolutionized. And this has made, of course, all the difference to all of this whole progress. Electronic computer. Now, when I was studying with hotelling before the war, in statistics courses, one of the troubles was that ordinary systems, or even something very ordinary like regression analysis, meant you had to invert a matrix. So if you had eight variables, you had to invert an eight-variable matrix. Now we had machines about the width of this and about so high. They cost, I would say, if you adjust for inflation, cost $6,000 to $8,000 today. And what they would do is you would enter. Let's say you had to add something. You put down the two numbers and you push the button. There's an electric motor. There were machines where you actually did it crank by hand, by the way. And I've worked on them. And the electric motor was simply a substitute for cranking by hand. There was nothing electronic about it. It was purely a motor. I was actually, during the war, as part of my attempts to do long-range weather forecasting, I decided to use statistical methods. I was fitting eight-variable regressions. And believe me, it was an 8-hour job. And I was pretty good at it, in case you have, in case you're, you got a sneaking suspicion. I really was pretty good at it. And so it was a miracle. Now, Hotelling was very concerned because he wanted statistics applied, and he knew that the computing was a bottleneck in this. It was perfectly easy to formulate all sorts of nonlinear problems, statistical estimation problems, which you could formulate and even get formulas for, but it was kind of pointless because you couldn't actually do anything with those formulas. Couldn't actually compute them. But he told us, I remember in class, that the AT&T had developed a machine using relays. Don't ask me quite what they are. Don't remember. He explained it then, but I didn't. Which could solve these problems. And of course, they could solve them, which meant, you know, you put it in and you could go away and they'd solve them. So at least your time wasn't involved. But they were very slow. But somebody pointed out the logic of them was the same as the logic of a vacuum tube. If you put an input at the plate, input at the, whatever it is, the filament, you could use with binary, reduce this to binary arithmetic, and you can do all the binary arithmetic calculations. And these, of course, obviously would operate at, I think, a built one. Well, one was actually built by some people at the University of Pennsylvania. It was called the ENIAC, Electronic Numerical Integrator and Computer. I think I've got that right. And as the war was over, but I had not yet been discharged, sitting in my office, a fellow walks in. He says, he's Professor so-and-so from Mauchly. That's right, Mauchly, from the University of Pennsylvania. And he and his colleague had developed this ENIAC. They had been doing work for the Navy, and their gunnery tables of some kind, and were through the job looking for another one. And somebody had told them that Lieutenant Arrow does a lot of calculating, which I admitted was true. So I said, what do? I said, I invert matrices. He didn't know what a matrix inversion was, which did not give me a great deal of confidence. He just told me how many arithmetic operations there are involved. So I told him, yeah, it'll take us 5 minutes. I thought, well, my parents had always told me, salesman, you don't. Professor or no professor, I was, you know. But, you know, on the other hand, he was very convincing. So I called up a meteorologist in the Navy. I figured he would have more contact with this, a meteorologist friend of mine. And he said, well, he's actually telling you the truth. However, he didn't tell you that the machine is out 80% of the time. Well, it had about 1,500 vacuum tubes, and you people have never seen a vacuum tube, but that was what powered our radios, and you knew in the middle of your favorite program, one of the two tubes was burnt out, so you kept a supply of spares so you didn't waste any time. You know, you have to be careful, they're very hot. But I figured 80% of the time, so it's 25 minutes instead of 5 minutes. I was taking 8 hours. It's clear, and I figured if it's a question of reliability somehow, that's the sort of thing I'll figure out. And so I came to the conclusion, I'd just seen a revolution. It took a few years. It took about 7 or 8 years before economists were allowed access to these machines. The universities would buy them and use them for accounting purposes. This university, I must say, was one of the more progressive in that respect. A new slide, please. At this point, operations research began to take off, and the group I was most connected with was the RAND Corporation. It was created, the argument was, now, one of the results was of the nuclear bomb, the atom bomb. There was a conviction, which some, at least some circles in the Air Force had, that there was a completely new world, and we had to have people who could think wildly in order to how to come to grips with it. I don't think they had any particular idea what they meant even. And of course, there was a new technique around, which fitted this niche, and that's game theory. It got a whole bunch of the first crop of Princeton PhDs who were involved in game theory, like Lloyd Shapley, and went into questions of how do you compute solutions? discovery that game theory and linear programming mathematics, let's say zero-sum games, theory of zero-sum games, and linear programming are very are mathematically extremely similar. The objects. And now, one of the things I got into was dynamic optimization, which there had been developed during, again, during the war, the idea of sequential analysis of statistical data. I won't try to explain that now, but you know, the idea is you keep, instead of saying a fixed, you know, I'm going to take a fixed sample, you keep on drawing the sample until you're convinced that you have enough evidence to stop. And this turns out, on the average, to lead to less. Well, you have the same control over the errors and less, on the average, less of drawing of statistical data. And you know, one of the first things I worked on there with my colleagues, well, this was now this point. Let me explain. I had already I was going to come to Stanford, and one of the reasons I was coming to Stanford, I was in Chicago, but it was one of the reasons I was coming to Stanford, was that they were creating a statistics department. Hotelling was emphatic about the need. Statistics shouldn't be taught by psychologists or economists. It should be an independent discipline. And a statistics department was created here. And it drew, on a, among other people, on a statistician named Meyer Gershick, who was at the RAND Corporation at this time, and was but a very distinguished theoretical statistician. And he so he was here. And this was what convinced me that I would come. So I still maintained a great interest in statistics. I would come here and be a joint appointment, possibly a joint appointment. I was offered a joint appointment in economics and statistics. This was during the year 48, 49. And one of the things I worked on in the summer of 48 was with Gershick and with David Blackwell, who subsequently from Howard University, who subsequently went to, unfortunately, to Berkeley. We tried to get him here, but that was one of my big disappointments. We can't win them all. Great, outstanding mind. Anyways, but this led to a way of thinking about problems, of dynamic problems, as recursive things where you're solving the same kind of problem but with maybe different initial conditions. So you want to get a formula for doing this, and that was the way we formulated, the three of us formulated sequential analysis, which had been developed by Abraham Wald. Then, 2 years later, there was a conference organized at RAND to help out the military on inventories. How much inventory should they hold? And this led a couple of us to formulate the problem. It turns out nobody had really formulated there had been some work on inventories even back in the 1920s, matter of fact, formally, but they were very a little too simple. They didn't catch what the obvious realities, how it's nothing subtle about it. And we were able to reformulate the problem. And this led to a complicated kind of optimization problem of a dynamic nature, of a recursive nature. This really set off, I may say so, a whole literature on inventory analysis, which is still continuing. Now it's supply chains and things like that, but that was the original emphasis was on. And of course, it led to, once you answer one question, a lot of others, you know, have about two commodities simultaneously, and there are all sorts of generalizations that immediately occur to you once you solve the first ones. And these developments led, there was a mathematician named Richard Bellman at RAND, who developed a general philosophy called dynamic programming, which is essentially the making great use of this recursive character to characterize solutions to problems and leading to computational methods. By now, of course, computers were beginning to proliferate. They were very big. by the way, and they used vacuum tubes. They were very hot. So you have these buildings with air, with lots of air conditioning where these things are run, but they were running. Then, of course, the later developments, you know better than I do. And Rand had its own big computer, as was done elsewhere. So Bellman formulated this as a time problem. We had now a general technique for optimization over time. Later, and maybe sort of independently, the Russian mathematician L.S. Pontryagin developed something called optimal control theory, which logically is equivalent to dynamic programming. It's the same thing, except it's presented in a different way. And actually, even though it was developed for things like rocket control, it actually is easier to give an economic interpretation to optimal control theory than it is to the dynamic programming. You have things that look like prices. Queuing theory was probably the biggest part of operations research in that field. There's a tremendous number of papers on queuing, you know, how to arrange things. And of course, linear and nonlinear programming began to proliferate. The nonlinear programming got developed, as well as linear programming, and various iterative methods of solution system became well known algorithms. And of course, the increasing power of the computer made a lot of algorithms practical, which wouldn't have been practical otherwise. And let me say briefly about the institutionalization of operations research. I'm thinking. As I mentioned, there was a statistics department which had been organized by Albert Bowker. He and I had been graduate students of statistics together at Columbia, and Gershick, who I mentioned. And I was an active member of that department, but I began to notice that there was an operations research capability developing. Jerry Lieberman, although he'd been originally a statistician, was really became interested in operations research problems. Samuel Carlin, although he was in the mathematics department, again was very interested in inventory problems and other kind of operations research problems. Richard Bellman came from Rand into the Stanford mathematics department. Harvey Wagner was a young student here who also began to develop these interests. And if I take the credit, it occurred to me we have room for, I wasn't bold enough to think of a department, but an interdepartmental degree, which there are several examples. I don't know if there still are, but they used to be anyway. It was not unheard of, where you could give a degree, even though there was but it'd be a committee which would set standards, but the courses were given in individual departments. And by this time, Bowker was a great administrator, later became chancellor at Berkeley, was in the assistant provost, I guess, and I formulated the idea of this program, and didn't take much effort to get Al enthusiastic about it. We got a separate interdepartmental degree. But then, of course, the problem that always comes in these things, we want to make a new appointment. It means you have to go around begging some department for the appointment. It was Arthur Vinod Jr., who died, unfortunately, a year ago, who was the person we were concerned with. And then I don't remember exactly the details, but I remember that somehow George Danziger, who by this time was at Berkeley, indicated something lack of, not as happy as he might be. And this would, of course, have been a great opportunity. So one way or another, we eventually created a department from this, and that's the Department of Operations Research, which through various developments, mergers, and so forth, is now part, has now emerged as part of the field of management science and engineering, combining with industrial engineering and the engineering economic systems departments. I finally conclude by noting the role, I mentioned there were two parts of microeconomics. One was the maximization part, and this is what I've been stressing up to this point. The other is the balancing part, the general equilibrium. And it turns out this is becoming a major problem, now, a major application, I'd say not a problem, a major application. First of all, there was a question whether the general equilibrium system as formulated was even consistent. There had been some German language literature in the 30s which cast some doubt on it. And it turned out to be a question of how you formulate it properly. And there had been a couple of papers, but they made very, very strong assumptions, too strong to be really desirable. And after John Nash published his famous paper on the existence of equilibrium points, several of us, in fact, about four or five people, as far as I can make out, independently thought of the idea that, oh, the mathematical methods used by Nash could be used to prove the existence of general equilibrium. Well, when Lionel McKenzie published a paper, Gerard Jabur and I developed this independently, found we were doing the same thing, and published the paper jointly. And there were about two other people who were just about there, Huku Kanina Kaido in Japan, David Gale, and I think there may have been one or two more. So this is one of those ideas that was clearly going to come. And the reason is very simple, the Nash's discovery. That gave rise to some people with ambition, like Herbert Scarf, who was here at Stanford for a while, and then later went to Yale, Curtis Eves, can we make this fixed point idea into a computational device? And they found methods, general methods, of solving the problem. Not exactly simple, but nevertheless, as computing power was growing, it became problems. And now, and I'll just conclude by mentioning that general equilibrium has become a tool of operations research in certain areas. In internet markets, you say the pricing of the advertising, the pricing of other services, you really want to equate supply and demand, and you want to do it in a way which is useful, leads to efficiencies, and so forth. And this has become a standard, the question of determining these general equilibrium. And they're interdependent because you want to reach several markets at the same time. And also there's the market for frequencies. In the television or more often internet services, you need certain frequencies if you use wireless. They interfere with each other, so you have to give a property right. Well, who owns that property right? It's really the government. The government used to give it away. If you look at the early history of radio and then television, the government would just give it away. But after a while, Ronald Coase, the economist, said, why should you give it away? If you want it efficiently done, you want to sell it to the highest bidder. And this is good for efficiency, and then the revenue is good for the government. So there began to be the idea of freeze. Well, then you have complicated things like the fact that I really would like to have it in two markets because I can do it together. So you want to bid simultaneously on two markets. And this is my colleague Paul Milgram has been going through these things. And they rely for inspiration on general equilibrium theory and things like that, but they are actually computable devices. And by now you can handle huge things that would have been incredible. But you are actually allocating resources and designing auction systems, for example, which is a kind of market, in order to do this. Well, I just hope you don't mind this little romp through history, and thank you very much for your patience.
So that was obviously fascinating. We have time for a few questions. Yes, there is a microphone.
To your dissertation.
There's a. What's that?
How did Tarski fit into your dissertation?
Tarski, okay. That's another story. In my senior year at college, the war broke out. See, the war broke out in 39-40, my last year of college, and the war broke out in September 39. Just so happened there was a conference. There had been a conference on logic in New York had been set up. People came, including Alfred Tarski. When the war broke out, he couldn't return to his, since it was Poland that was attacked, he could not return to his homeland. The City College Department of Philosophy had an unfilled vacancy, so they somebody had the brain. Somebody there had the brains to approach him and say, "Would you like to teach? Since you're stuck in this country anyway, what would you like to teach?" Tarski, however, knew no English. believe me, I'm not exaggerating. So he was a very responsible person. He said, "Well, I'll start in February for the spring term. I'm not going to try to teach now." And so he gave, but he gave a couple of courses, and one of them was on the calculus of relations. You know, X bears a relation R to Y, like X is the father of Y, or X is bigger than Y, or something like that. But he didn't. He had some presentation where he's doing it in a very formal way. So you don't. You just. I won't try to do this. But an abstract formulation of this. Well, he was also giving another course in sort of basic logic, but I felt I had read enough on my own not to bother with that. So I didn't know what relations were, but I figured if it's an advanced course, it's given by Alfred Tarski. I knew enough. That was enough. And he started giving lectures and defining these concepts very carefully, very rigorously, introducing all sorts of concepts of multiplying relationships and adding them and so forth. So it was a kind of a formal calculus of these relationships. The first couple of days, none of us knew what he was talking about. Not because of the content. We just couldn't understand the words. and I remember a few of us held little conferences trying to figure out what it is exactly. That was the problem, you know. We finally decided it was not the pronunciation of the individual letters. We could correct for, you know, in New York you heard foreign accents all over the place, so it was not, although Polish was not a particularly, it was not, and Poland's not well represented in New York. The Poles all went to the Midwest. But the stresses within the sentences were different than the way we'd stress parts. It wasn't. So we finally figured that out, and we'd exchange notes as to what he actually said. And in about a week, we were not sure whether we got understood him better or he got better, but somehow the communication. So it was absolutely a wonderful course. This thing. That's okay, no particular. Then I took this course in mathematical economics, and they're talking about bundle X is preferred to bundle Y. I said, oh, these are relations. This is what Tarski was talking about. And well, it didn't, of course, just translate from one language to another is not that interesting. I mean, that's just a nice observation. But this gave me a knowledge of a way to think about relations. Then Rand was in a view that anything is possible, so you can talk about anything. He even had philosophers on their staff, to give you an idea. And in fact, one of the philosophers on the staff was the fellow who had translated Tarski's textbook on basic logic and sentential calculus into English. Translated from German into English, yeah. And in fact, Tarski had asked me, would I proofread this? So the summer of 40, I met this philosopher, Olaf Helmer, who was German, a German. Helmer turns out to be a philosopher. When I get to Rand, 8 years later, there's Helmer. So I already knew him. And he was concerned about game theory. Why are we studying game theory? We're studying game theory because the United States and the Soviet Union are playing games. I kid you not. However, he was worried. So game theory is based on what an individual does. The United States and the Soviet Union are not individuals. They're collectivities of some kind. You sort of have to aggregate their preferences to make a social preference. Oh, I said, no, yeah, that's, yeah, the economists have been talking about that. There's a paper on social welfare functions by Abram Bergson, and, you know. Oh, I said, why don't you write it up? Well, as soon as I started reading it, thinking about it to write up, I realized Bergson had not raised the right questions. What he did was correct, but it wasn't really an answer to the question. It didn't take account of that. This is not the place for a lecture on social choice. So I realized that things were basically a question of a social ordering and a bunch of individual orderings. And ordering was a particular kind of relationship, having satisfying certain conditions. And the other thing, one thing led to, that's what led me to think about it in those terms, which I think turned out to be the fruitful way of looking at it. Answer your question.
Yes.
Hi, it was mentioned that 5 of your students got Nobel Prizes. What advice do you have for students in this room?
I'm sorry, could you speak? I couldn't hear you.
So it was mentioned that 5 of your students got Nobel Prizes.
Yeah.
What advice do you have for students in this room?
You know, this is a problem. You know, one thing it has, one of the topics I've thought about my lifetime has been the theory of innovation. Now, after all, there's a general view now that in the long run, economic growth is basically a question of innovations and their adaptation, and their adoption, I should say, that this is what contributes. But it has struck me that a theory of innovation is essentially impossible because it's new, right? So nobody thought, if you could anticipate innovation, you've already made it. So the answer is, I don't think there's any way of answering your question. However, I don't know. There's one thing that is relevant, isn't it? It's not an answer, is criticism. And that's what a thesis advisor can advise. A person, of course, should in the first place be self-critical. You come up with an idea, the first thing you figure is, what's wrong with it? And you think about it that way. And I think then a thesis advisor can sometimes contribute that particular kind of, quote, help, unquote.
Yes.
This is concerned the operations research during the war. I have heard that in order to come up with a way of providing resources for a moving war front, they actually use ants. With the supply of food on one side, and they would count the ants, and they would cut the cord or whatever it was, and it would simulate a bridge going out. Do you know anything about that?
That sounds like an ingenious idea.
Yes.
What do you see as the future of applying these ideas to modeling bigger problems like how to manage the economy or how to develop wiser fiscal and economic policies? And how do you see that playing out?
Well, you're very quick to point to the weak. You're good at pointing out the weak problems. Yes, a part of it has been theoretical. You say, we assume the economy, this and this, what happens if you impose a tax? What happens if you subsidize research and development? Now that sort of running an economy is that sort of thing. What happens how much the taxes interfere or promote growth? That's the kind of typical questions. And the sources of evidence are, one is you have a theoretical model, you draw some inferences, but you can say, well, who knows this theoretical model is correct. Another possibility is to look at history. Of course, history is a pretty uncontrolled experiment. Too many other things are going on. And there's another paradox. We're studying ourselves. And this is a problem with all the social sciences. And the question is, can we get away? You really have to go. I mean, you talk about ants, you see. You can study ants. It's pretty hard to study human beings because we project, of course, ourselves into other human beings. And that's partly good. That's a source of knowledge, but it's not exactly an unbiased source of knowledge. There's no really good answer because, you know, for example, if you take financial crises, which is a particular, I mean, it's not the only kind of disturbance the economy has had, but the last one was a financial crisis. Where the financial sector was the locus. One of these characteristics is that no two financial crises are really alike, exactly alike. Once there's trouble, of course, the government may act by prohibiting something. For example, after the Great Depression, we changed the margin requirements on stock market. Used to be 5%, it was 50% now. Which I think was a good idea, but I can't prove it. You got stocks are not such a good subject for speculation anymore. So you develop something else. We have these, now we have the latest version of these collateral-backed securities. In other words, the particular securities that are actually at stake tend to be different from one crisis to another. So it's very hard, it becomes hard, that's due to the ingenuity of the financial sector, of course. They know that there's a bad reaction, even if the government didn't do anything, by the way. People, the buyers would say, gee, look what happened last time. Now you give them something different. in fact, there's a book that's one of the leading books that's been on the subject of financial crisis has the title, This Time It Will Be Different. Rogoff and Reinhardt books, that's a general expectation. That's why it's extremely difficult because the world has changed. The world is always in a new state. The economic world is always in a new state, and let me say there's no. You just have to observe, and we see how even wise observers make mistakes. I think we're going to just. I think this kind of occasional failure. You can try to anticipate. I think one of the things, at least you should learn from the past, and we're not even doing that.
Yes. I'd like to ask a very narrow question. What is your view of the prospect for operations research as a field?
Oh. Well, what is done under the heading of operations research will be, I think, is a permanent addition. It may take different forms, and the field may splinter in some ways, corresponding to different kinds of applications. I mean, specialization will develop, is developing, I think. So I don't think it's interesting how the connection with microeconomics, which is kind of a bigger group of people on the whole, has continued and is still very dynamic. And it affects, I haven't really gone into this lecture to save time in the opposite direction. Operations research has affected economics a lot. So I think the activity called operations research is permanent. We have a much better data than we used to have. We have the idea of using analytic methods. We have computers which enable us to do much more deeply with analytic methods, and we probably have better. We have better data sources, and what's more is the dissemination of data is extraordinary. It's much, much easier than it used to be. You can get data from other places. In a way, just the sheer transmission is just much easier than it was. So I think we affirm that if you want to study what the effect of a change in the health system is, for example, what happens if you do a new regulation about how to reimburse doctors or how to reimburse hospitals. I think you can get relevant information on that much more easily than you could have gotten 50 years ago, you can test theories better. So I think I think my view is that operations research is as an activity is a permanent. The name may disappear, but I don't think the activity ever will.
Okay. Maybe one more question. Yes?
After Stalin, did the former Soviet Union use some of these mathematical methods as part of its central planning process, and how well did they do with that?
Now, the central planning process never worked at all. It was really part of it was just a plain data overload. But I think at the firm level, you got the use of operations research. I don't think at the national level it was any use at all. And I think the more they got into it, the less they even pretended. I remember I was really surprised in 1979, I think it was. I'm not sure now. I went with a delegation of the American Economic Association to China. And we went to talk to the planning authorities. They had all been trained in the Soviet Union. They were quite open. So the Chinese talked much more openly than the Russians ever did, even then. They really couldn't plan. If by plan you mean coal mine A has to send so much coal to steel mill B, they had all these orders. They issued these orders all the time. But the way they did it was the coal mine, the steel mill B would send out a fellow to find some coal mine who could deliver the goods. They'd agree, and then they would send this up as a request. And they would then order to do what they had requested. So they were perfectly open to the fact that these methods, which they had learned from the Russians, simply there was no practical way of actually doing it. So I think the answer is at the national level, I think planning has turned out to be, certainly detailed planning. I'm not talking about things like total government expenditures or something like that. But detailed planning has really not functioned. It isn't so much that it's good or bad. It's essentially non-existent. It's impractical. And I think that's been true. The Western Europe, after all, was experimenting. Say, if you look at the 1940s and even early 50s, there was a lot of talk about planning with a private sector. The French, particularly, were very good at theorizing and rationalizing. Were very good at ideas, even though some of them were quite practical. But they just didn't actually matter. Nobody paid attention to them, really. Even the Japanese, who were very disciplined, were the automobile industry started. So some firms want to make automobiles. The Ministry of International Trade and Commerce said, that's ridiculous. You can't compete in the world market. But they went ahead anyway. The government was controlling the credit sources. You think they have a lot of power? It didn't matter. But at the firm level, things are entirely different. And there, I think there's been the Russians. Some of the Russian firms have done very well with this.
Terrific. Well, I'm sure this conversation could go on for hours. And Ken, I think we'll stay around for at least a little bit of time. There are refreshments and drinks out back. Please catch up with old friends. But let's begin by thanking Ken again for a really wonderful time.
Thank you very much.
That was terrific. That was just terrific. Thank you.